Now this is Hollywood Unlocked. Yo, it's Hollywood Unlocked Uncensored. I'm Jason Lee.
Hey, it's DJ Damage.
Okay, listen, my brother's in the building. We've been talking on the phone. He's been inspiring me, Taylor Bennett.
Hey.
You know,
Jason.
Taylor. Okay.
Okay, we flexing. I see what's going on here.
What we're not going to do is come in here flexing muscles. We get it. You're fit now.
See the abs. Look, I'm not going to hold you down. Right, real quick.
Pull your shirt down.
Wait, but the camera angle was kind of more on your crotch, so you may just want to stay seated.
It was a lot. It was.
Everybody says, you know what I'm saying? Good content is good content. You know what I'm saying? Serve it as you must.
Hey, Hollywood Unlocked never complains. All right, but listen, you know what's so crazy is you've never been on the show, but you've actually helped me get your brother Chance on, which I appreciate it. And I just have to say there's people in the industry that you can call up and it becomes a whole bunch of politicking and this and that. And you literally not only got us your brother Chance, but at the iHeart Festival when you did it, I guess whatever was communicated, the president came over like, yo, y'all got to do something because Chance said he's only going to talk to you. And I'm like, hey, man, you got to go talk to Taylor.
He's only going to talk to you. No, that's right. And, you know, Jason, I really appreciate you. I can't tell you enough, and I know I say this to you whenever we get a chance to converse personally. You're a mentor to me. There's so many different people that look up to you for everything that you've done, everything that you do. You have no fear. You're always truthful about what you want to say. You're a true journalist, and that is a commodity and something that is very, very rare, precious. So anytime that, you know, not just for me, I know you're going to make my brother look good. You made me look good. I think, didn't you have me on your hoodie? Didn't you have a picture of me on your hoodie?
Well, let's slow down. Yeah. Okay, so.
Did you see the hoodie? He didn't see the hoodie, did he?
He saw the hoodie.
Oh, he saw the hoodie.
He saw the hoodie. He loved the hoodie.
Okay.
He thought
that- Actually, I've had Chance on my hoodie twice. And this is when you, Chance, Taylor. Let me get this right. I don't want to create no other.
Even Jason does it, so it's all good. Yeah.
No. I don't want to mix it up because they're gonna be like, all right, now you don't be trying Chance. Then here come all the Chance the Rapper fans. No, actually, I've had Taylor on my sweater twice. One, when he was on Wildin' Out, I think it said I love Taylor Bennett or something on the back of my sweater. And then like his girl is like, oh, let me take a picture of that. I'm like, oh, this is fucking weird, you know?
You know what? I think Kayla loves you so much. And I think that something that's really dope about just like that relationship, and I think that's a testament of just who you are again, is like, I remember when me and you first started conversing, and anytime you start talking to anybody in the industry, it's fishy because we don't know who the fuck you are. Like, I didn't grow up with you. I don't know you like that. But one thing that I'd always liked about you is that I had read a couple of your articles already, and I felt like you were just truthful in everything that you did. And like I said, that's something that's very, very rare. So I feel like when Kayla first met you, believe it or not, Jason, I think you're one of my first friends that Kayla was just like, I love this guy. He's super duper cool. I want to hang out with him when he's in Chicago. We should try to kick it with him. And she even follows your work and just everything you do. So, I think you kind of helped me with that, too.
No, she's really cool. I mean, it's kind of uncomfortable because, you know, when I first saw you, of course, I was in love with you. You know that, right? And it was more of like...
No, I didn't know.
Oh, yeah, let him know.
Time out. You were?
He's the only one that doesn't know, Jason.
I won't stay in love. I mean, I grew an immediate infatuation. You know what I mean? Like, but
I appreciate that.
But we're... Boy, listen. Now we've grown as family, so it's kind of weird, you know what I mean? Like, okay. Then when I interviewed your brother Chance at the festival, I had you on my sweater. So when he walked in, he was like, oh, wow, okay. I'm like, yeah, this is a different kind of interview, bro. You know what I mean? Like, I'm this close to the family.
Believe it or not, I think you having me on your hoodie was instantly the thing that made Chance be like, because, you know, Jason, you know.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
And, what does Jason know? Wait, fill me in because I don't know. What's
no, but
on?
meaning I'll like,
I'll fill you in. You don't gotta do it. Let me take care of this for you real quick. I mean, I think that there's a lot of people that kind of have this negative connotation of who Jason Lee is based off the fact that he writes really good stories. And I think that if you're in the entertainment industry and you're going to talk about what you do or put private business out or whatever the situation is, it's a business. right? Like, I feel like me and Jason are really open with each other, but I'm sure there's certain things that Jason might not tell me and I might not tell him. And that's just common sense. So I think that that is out there. But again, another testament to who you are and how dedicated you are and the relationships that are actually real, unlike a lot of these people connections, I was on your hoodie when you walked in. And yeah. I know that that made my brother, you know what I'm saying? Like, okay, this guy is genuine.
Yeah.
You know what I'm
but
saying?
But what makes it easy to be friends with you and Chance and Kayla is our jobs don't drive the relationships. You know, what we do doesn't drive our relationship. And also, I think the other thing that makes it easy to be friends with you all is because what you see with you guys is what you get. Chance is Chance. You are you. You guys present yourselves the way who you are. And like you said, there may be things that we don't share, but that's just us, you know, having privacy and discretion. Yeah.
Common sense.
But I think it makes it easy being, you know, because I had told the story on the show when I met Rihanna. The first thing she said to me was, I know it's so hard being friends with people like me doing what you do. But as a businesswoman, I respect how you built your brand. And like, you know, I feel bad that you get attacked for telling the truth. But look, I know sometimes I say some crazy shit, too, and I need to be attacked, you know,
only sometimes,
but only sometimes. Now I'm just fucking around. You did the whole thing. This is what I also like about you. There's a lot of people that put it out, but they can't dish that shit. They can't handle it. And the whole thing about you is that if I ever see you say something, I know that you're standing behind it. I know that there's probably now I know you're open-minded. You'll listen to suggestions and ideas, but I'm pretty sure that the ideology that you've created in your mind is what you're going to work by and what you're going to move on. I can respect that. You know, so.
But this is the thing, and this is why I thought, and that's a great setup for why we're talking today, because Taylor and I have been friends for a while now. We've grown an admiration for each other on social topics, on the LGBT conversations happening online. And more importantly, there's not a lot of people that I feel close to that could relate enough and have the empathy enough to be able to have these kind of conversations because we both come from similar places. But what, you know, and I appreciate everything you said about me, but let me just return it and say that one thing about you from the over the last year that's really motivated me is you talk about I stand behind what I say and do what I say. You every single day are on your Instagram working out. And it's not even like 3 days a week or 4 days a week. I know that I can roll over to Instagram. Well, I got to roll past the cute boy laying next to me, but I know I'll roll over and I know that you're there motivating your followers to get fit. And the thing about it is that sometimes we do things and we don't even really realize that we're inspiring people. And I don't even know if you started doing all that because you wanted to inspire people, but you inspired me. And so now, you know, I'm on my journey and that's where we connected this past week on like where I'm at. You know, you followed a different journey, but you've been so inspiring. So what inspired you to lose the love handles and, you know what I mean, get fit and become this little sex god out in Chicago?
I think the biggest thing that inspired me was my son. You know, I found out I was going to be a dad, and it scared me.
But this is with Charlie.
Yeah, specifically this is Charlie. So this is my first son. I have two children now, two sons. But the first one, Charlie, I found out I was having Charlie, and it scared me. And I'll tell you why. And this is just for me. I can't speak for everybody, but I can speak from my experience. I come from the south side of Chicago, from 79th. My dad has worked in, you know, really streets and sanitation and then eventually got into politics, you know, opened a lot of doors for us in terms of connections. But, you know, it was still pretty hard just growing up. We lived in a hood, you know, lower middle class family. And I realized at that point, right before I had Charlie, that I had done things I never thought I would ever do. I had made money that I never thought I would make. You know, my brothers won fucking Grammys, you know, doing Tonight shows. You know, I'm friends with Jason Lee. You know what I'm saying? But I realize I'm in this position and I'm still unhealthy. So I've acquired all of this wealth, but mentally I'm unhealthy. Spiritually, I'm unwealthy, right? Family-wise, I'm unwealthy. Like the relationships that I was having and the things that were going on and the people that it was all so much. And it seemed like, you know, you guys, you know, you have those days where it's just like nonstop, nonstop, mm-hmm. nonstop. And then it's like you get the smallest amount of sleep. and then you get back up and it's nonstop, nonstop, nonstop. And then that just becomes a routine. And that's where I was, man. Like I was, you know, up in the middle of the nights, I'm eating stuff at 12 o'clock. You know, I got to smoke before I go to sleep. You know, just all these different things. And I felt like I wanted to fix that. I felt like I had money and clearly just obtaining it or having it wasn't enough. I needed to be educated. And my best friend, Zakor Stewart, who's also from my neighborhood, is my, you know, one of my biggest inspirations, because he's been vegan. His mom's been vegan, almost her whole life. And she raised him to be vegan. And he had different points in time where we skipped out. But like I said, I don't know if you guys know, but in Chicago, we have these things called food deserts, which is a certain amount of miles in a location where you can't find anything but a McDonald's or a Subway. And that's at best.
But so, is that in the black communities, in the urban communities?
And I don't even want to just say black communities. These are urban communities. Yeah. This isn't downtown. So if my mayor's watching this, this isn't downtown. Where I live and she lives in, there's some kind of where she lives. I think she lives in like Logan Square on the north, near Northwest Side, kind of a Hispanic Latino community. Very, very beautiful, very prestigious. There's food deserts there. So food deserts are anywhere where there is a lack of money, anywhere there is a lack of
resources. You know,
resources, you're going to find a food desert. And I grew up in a food desert. And my friend Zakor, who is literally putting me on this information, and I'll tell you, like, just how sometimes I call you, Jason, I make you feel guilty about shit that I see you doing. He was making me feel guilty. He's like, bro, you about to have a kid. You live downtown. You got this nice ass house. You know what I'm saying? You working with all these people, and
there's no excuses. You got the resources. There's no excuses.
And he's telling me, he's like, you're not taking advantage of everything you got. Like, you're literally watching it go down the drain. And for what? To be comfortable, you know? And I think that scared me, because I thought about how many multimillionaires are there that are unhealthy. So many. Mm-hmm. He's the same person that taught me, just as well as my father, balance. It's mm-hmm. all about balance. It's too many, and it's too many of us. And when I say us, black people or people of color that suffer from not being educated, and that's mm-hmm. not at the fault of our own, right? Not having the resources, and that's not at the fault of our own. And I believe, just like you, Jason, and that's why I told you I'm so happy for you, you're getting the education, but you've had money for a little minute, and yeah. that's nothing to be ashamed of, yeah. but you want to make a difference, and you want to make a change, and you want to do something that makes other people look at you and say, I could do that too.
Well, I think, and like you said, you know, the one thing that I was told a long time ago by Floyd was that no matter how much, because he saw I wanted the house and I wanted the cars mm-hmm. and I wanted all that. He said, no matter how much of that you get, that will not make you happy. And you know, I've heard Oprah say it years over, like, money only amplifies who you are. And when I look at people around me, like, you build up your empire, you build up your business and your brand, and then like you lose yourself. It's like, you know, and then, yeah. And so let me ask you, because for me, you know, I had the surgery, but, you know, I tell people, like, the surgery is for the weight loss, but there's still the whole fitness part that has to happen.
Fitness part.
For you, when you decided to do it, because for me, I mean, it was really hard to start, you know, like, were you ever, like, ready to give up? Like, was it really hard at the beginning?
Yo, man, I'll tell you, you know, I had, like I said, I had a couple things that had happened in my lifetime, or just around that span. I was having Charlie, but I had just put out a project, Be Yourself. I was comfortable. I'll tell you, mm-hmm. you know, one thing, and I'll give you an example. I think I said this to you the other day on the phone, possibly. Have you ever seen the tiger or the lion that is doing tricks at the circus? And there's that little man that's whipping him with that very small whip. He is like 100 times smaller than this tiger. The reason why that tiger allows himself to not maul off his face is because he has been so oppressed that he no longer knows his identity, and he no longer knows his strength, and he no longer knows his values or what he can do. And what they do to us is that they take it away. I'm from Chicago. I went to school. I grew up on 79th Street. I grew up right up the street from Inglewood, which is supposedly one of the worst neighborhoods in America, according to a lot of people. They compare it to the Middle East and, you know, so many different places that we as Americans might view and say, oh, how could that be? And one thing that I can definitely say is that they don't give us the tools, they don't give us the information. And eventually, I'll tell you, Jason, like you just said, even if you become successful, I have very many successful friends, we still end up in some way losing ourselves by harming ourselves. Maybe it's food, maybe it's drugs, maybe it's addiction, maybe it's, you know, sexual addiction, maybe it's, but it's, we don't give ourselves time. And I think I told you this yesterday. I knew I was going to take this serious when I started going to the gym 2 to 3 hours a day. And I started getting calls from people like my dad and Kayla and Chance saying, hey, you're in the gym too much. You shouldn't be in the gym this much. And, you know, not just them. The only reason I mention them are those are the people I care about most. But, you know, I got definitely some more, I think, disturbing calls from some other people just saying, what's going on? Like, you never worked out. You've never eaten healthy. You're not eating red meat. You're not eating pork. You're going to the gym for all these hours a day. What is going on? Are you okay? And that let me know that if giving myself personal time for 2 to 3 hours or to do something that is going to push me to evolve to another level or take things to another platform, if that makes people feel like I'm taking something away that they depend on, then I'm not doing it enough. You get what I'm saying? Yeah. Then I'm not there enough, because that's a feeling that you get accustomed to. Yeah. I don't want to be in the house. I just told you today, I swear to God, I was supposed to ride my bike. And that's me. You know me, Jason. I'm still out on the streets. I still love to see people. I still love to ride my bike. I just rode my bike to 65th out south. You know, no security. Saying hello to my people. Ride my shit back downtown. Not saying a word to anybody. I was just fucking around.
But you said 13 miles, though.
That's a lot of miles. 13 miles.
I was only supposed to do 2 miles, but God makes everything happen for a reason, Jason. I was kind of bothered this morning. I won't get into it. It's really, I didn't get enough sleep. I was at the studio late. Charlie woke me up early. You got to take care of your son. By the time, you know, the nanny and Kay got out for their walk, my phone was dead. I don't have to tell you guys. If your phone is on 1% and you want to leave your house and you don't have a charger, it ruins your day. So I had to wait there. I'm waiting there. Finally get on my bike, head over to the Apple store, and it's closed because in Chicago we're looting. And, you know, just to give you a little bit of perspective on how I feel about that, I live downtown. You know, I pay taxes like everybody else. Stop killing us. Stop killing black kids. Stop killing people of color. You know, my ancestors were slaves. I didn't come here by choice. Mm. You know, every single day that, you know, I wake up and, you know, to do what I do and for all of us to do what we do, it's a struggle. Everybody, black or white. So, you know, don't, you know, I've been seeing too many people saying too many negative things, speaking on a city that they're not from. And, you know, if there's one thing I won't do and the Bennetts won't do, we won't let anybody speak down on our city. If you're not from here, you know, you can comment on it. We'd love your help. But, you know, keep that same energy, you know, when there's babies dying. Keep that same energy, you know, in 2014, 2013, when they cut off the red line. And before I started riding my bike and jogging and I was trapped in my neighborhood, you know, I just lost a friend 3 weeks ago in my old neighborhood. We lost somebody that, you know, I had a great deal of respect for as well, downtown Chicago. And now it's a big thing. Come on.
What do you say to people who say, well, Chicago, there's so much black on black crime? You know, they always try to throw in the fact that there's crime in our communities.
So check this out. So this is what I say. As African-Americans, we make up 13% of America, right? So for anybody to be trying to make any comparison between 13% of America and 73% of the population of America and trying to correlate those numbers of crime or police brutality, you're automatically wrong. If those numbers are anywhere near each other, you're automatically wrong. If you don't understand that when Malcolm X and Martin Luther King were around and they were talking about the civil rights era and the Civil War, that mass incarceration did not exist yet. If Malcolm X and Martin Luther King were here today and knew that one out of every 15 black men were incarcerated, they would lose their mind, because most of us don't realize it every day that we walk around. You know, there is black on black crime. There's white on white crime. We have wars, you know.
Or there's just crime, period.
Hold up, Jason. I just want to say, because, you know, I want everybody to understand, I love my country. I love America. I think that America can be great. I think it can be, but I think that we all need to be better. We all need to be better. You know, when you talk about Chicago and you're talking about looting and you're comparing clothes to a life, you're wrong. And I'm not the person to, you know.
How do you feel when, and I've seen people in Chicago say this, where there's not the same outrage for when there is black on black crime or whatever you want to call it, and police brutality. How do you feel about that?
I think it's just kind of, you know, and I think this is, you know, this is why I do this, because, you know, I'm Taylor Bennett, pick my real name. You know, this is why I put out Be Yourself, the project, so I could keep it 100. So I'll keep it 100 with you. You know, I can't make this clear enough to you. You know, there's three people that I believe have African descent on this phone call. You didn't forcefully come here. Somebody took you. Somebody took your ancestors. Somebody put our ancestors in hot tar. Somebody for years has oppressed you. And they've how about the Housing Act, right? It's not enough to talk about mass incarceration. How about the crack epidemic? You know, it's not enough to talk about that. How about the fact that schools are more segregated now than they were when Martin Luther King was here? It's not enough to talk about that. How about the fact that in Chicago, this is specific, I could speak to Chicago's about Section 80 and what that tactic was like when they went into the Robert Taylor or Townsend homes and knocked down all of these stacked up projects that they had created, these low income houses, and then spread us all around Chicago, all around, you know, Carbondale, you know, to all these different places, and basically merged us as a people that had created a culture around the welfare system that did not allow black fathers to be present in the home in order to receive this check so families could benefit themselves. We had to affiliate with other levels of work that might be considered crime or heinous. Those are the reasons why we're locked up in jail. Those are the reasons why we don't have fathers in our community. Another reason is generational wealth. Me and my brother are two independent artists. And I'll say this, this is on my own terms. This has nothing to do with Chance. As an independent artist, I believe, and I believe this as a kid, and this is the reason why I'm not signed to a record label like a lot of other major big artists. As an African American, I don't know what generational wealth is if it's not my music and ownership. When you look at other groups of people, they have created something that their culture is attached to in terms of a generational wealth. Still, as African Americans, in 2020, we do not own our work, we do not sell our own product, and we do not understand, even if we wanted to, how to do so. Because every time an artist wants to put out a mixtape, every time an artist wants to put out a music video, they want to buy it. They want to give us an advance. They want to own it. And when I say they want to own it, and to be more specific,
well, and just for people who are listening to the show, let's just say they throughout the show is white people.
No, let's not say they throughout the show is white people.
Well, who is they? So we could define them.
Time out. There's definitely black people that do own shit. There's black people that have done well. There's no way that we could compare that to white people, which adds again to what I was talking about in terms of the crime weight against, you know, police brutality or black on black crime. We can't compare those two.
Because, no, I'm speaking specific to the music labels. I'm not talking about the mass. I'm talking about, we were talking about independent artists.
But you ain't gonna sit right here and tell me that it ain't no black people in the industry. That done some other black people Very.
Oh, yeah, oh, of course. But see, that's different. When you look at the 1%, those are not black people. Those are the they. Now, the house niggas in the industry that go out and do the dirty work of oppressing, finding talent and oppressing the talent is different. I call them the house niggas.
Only there's so many levels, though, and I don't like to give names and examples. And you know what? Actually, I'm not going to do that. What I am going to do, though, is say this. We can be better. And that is my that is the push is we can be better. Yeah. We can all be better. Now, there's definitely a push that needs to be made. I think a lot more on some sides. But let's not break this shit down to black and white. Let's not break this shit down again.
But we have to. The audience doesn't understand who they is. And I feel like when we're talking about a specific issue specific to oppression. We have to define who they is.
No, and that's not right. And that's not cool. And the reason why I'll say that's not okay is because in that same technical aspect, then somebody could say, you know, those black kids are shooting each other in Chicago. So who gives a damn? But that's not true. All white people aren't fucked up. Is the majority of white people do I think all white people are, you know, susceptible or, you know, open about the prehistoric events that have occurred to put us where we are? No. Do I think they could be more honest? Yes. Do I think they're falsely educated? Of course. I think that the Confederate Party and the conservatives, for years, they say they might have lost the battle of the Civil War, but they won the battle of education. Why do you think that there are wars right now about monuments? Because that means something to them. And they don't think that guy is racist, I'll tell you. They would sit right here and argue with you, but is that guy racist? Probably.
Yeah.
But were they educated to know he was racist? No.
Right.
So what we're doing, and we got to understand that, it's not okay. And Jason, you got to understand that. It's important for you to understand that because you are in a bigger position than I am on the daily with the platform. You know these white, we know, ain't nobody blind. Don't nobody, I'm younger than all of y'all. Ain't nobody blind. We know what's
right,
going
on. Right, but okay, so me, and this is, you know, we all reserve the right to say shit how we say shit, right? And I leave everybody to feel implored to do whatever they got to do. When we say they, and I was speaking specific to the music industry, because that's the topic that we were on, and then it kind of got broad. When we talk about they, for me, I think our audience would need to understand who is they, because I think the problem is when we talk about specific forms of oppression, it's specifically talking about the music industry, right? If there's the 1%, because me, I own Hollywood Unlocked. I own everything. I could say anything I want. Everything. Even iHeart, I own the show. You know, so I think I am with you on the fact that, like, we have to have ownership. You and Chance as independent artists choosing to stay in control and create that generational wealth for your children and your families. Brilliant. I think a lot of people respect you all for that. I'm saying specifically, I'm just trying to define when we say they, you know, when we talk about, like, they had the resources. When we talk about food deserts, who is they? I said they had to be white people because. Oh, no.
Well, they was the government. What I was talking about.
Oh, they the government. Okay.
Yeah.
Right. When we talk about, like, you know, once we start to get to really the level of systematic oppression. So, like, structuring a community where, you know, like the school that the neighborhood I grew up in, our park was fucked up. We had a school and they took the school from us and made it a private school. And then everybody went to this even more fucked up neighborhood high school. And then, you know, so it's like, and that's what I think is very important. And that's something that I also want to put out there is that we as a people have to understand that racism. This could be wrong, and I want to also just say this for anybody that's watching this shit. I'm 24 years old. I got a lot more to learn. Please comment. Please educate me. I'm open-minded, and that's all I want to do is learn more. But this is what I want to say. As a 24-year-old African-American male, I could say that I really think that most of my white friends, they don't know that they're privileged. Like, even if we've
it's
told
an ignorance,
them that.
For sure. It's an ignorance.
It is an ignorance. But check it out. Check it out. Check it out. It's an ignorance, or they believe it's an ignorance on our part, of black-on-black crime. Somebody is stringing all this shit together. There is a way that when you are so focused on somebody or a group of people that is taking away from you, and you spend so much time on figuring out how to create that structure where you are, you know, maybe the first class citizen, you lose all focus of the actual people that are in charge, right? And I think that, and just from my perspective, again, I'm not white, but I think that I have white friends that I've been recently having some heated conversations with, and they're saying shit that I never knew they felt like, but I'm taking that shit on myself because I should have either checked them motherfuckers when they said some shit 4 years ago when I was 18 or whatever the situation was, or I should have explained things to them. Like, I'll give you an example. Tupac Shakur, I think, to a lot of people in the black community, this is another example. Let me just say my friends, because I don't even want to say the whole community. I don't know the whole black community. I don't know the whole white community. But in my community, my friends, if I ask my black friends, like, who was Tupac? Or if you ask them, they'd be like, yo, Tupac was one of the biggest activists. His mom, Masai Shakur, one of, you know, the Black Panthers. You know, he made Brenda's Got a Baby. He made changes. He told us to eat better. He told us to, if you ask one of mine, these are my white friends again. If you ask one of my white friends what Tupac, they would say that he invented gangster rap. I think both of those things are accurate.
No, it's not.
They're accurate. No.
Tupac didn't invent gangster rap. We had NWA.
You're real. Let me take that back. But check this out.
I know what you're saying, though.
He's talking about this generation.
What he's talking about is the content more than I get what you're saying.
He's talking about these millennials running around here. These millennials running around here talking about Too Short invented gangster rap.
I felt old when he said that.
To put y'all on.
You can't put me on if niggas is telling you Tupac can been a gangsta rap.
I'm putting you on, Jason. You don't know. I'm putting you on a different mind because y'all can't think like me. I'm too young. Check this out. Y'all know that he wasn't the first gangster rapper. But let me ask you a question.
I mean, y'all damn, he's only 30.
Y'all think NWA or Tupac is more wide known? I think those are the two largest wide known rappers besides Biggie outside of the black culture. Would y'all say that?
And Jay-Z.
Okay, cool.
Nice.
You got a couple of my white friends. Let me say my white friends again. They would be like, yeah, he made that gangster rap. And that's what I'm saying, is that it doesn't mean that they're right, but I do think that we all need to understand this needs to start being a we thing, because the biggest tool of racism, I believe, are not the biggest tool, but one of the biggest tools of racism is segregation, is the idea of separating us and saying separate but equal. That was the whole thing, was that they literally, white people will tell you that was around back in segregation. I've seen this shit on YouTube and documentaries. They literally say, I had no idea what was going on the other side of that wall at my school.
But let me say this. I think that racism was started by white people. I love white people. My mother was Italian. I love white people. Black people were minding their own business, picking berries and hanging in the rivers of Jordan or hanging out over in Africa. And white people went to go get them and bring them here. And then from bringing us here, they didn't bring us here on a tour ship, on a vacation. They brought us here for years and years and years of free work. And then told us after we built this bitch that we weren't good enough.
I love when we have conversations about they, but I think right now in our community, we need to have a solid conversation about us. Jason represents Stockton. You represent Chicago. I represent Philadelphia. If you look anywhere on Google, we represent some of the highest crime rate, the murder rate. And I do feel like us as a community, we can keep talking about they, because they, the oppressors, you know, they did cause this. But at some point, there's some responsibility I feel like we need to take as a community and build up our community. And I do feel people sometimes when they say there's not enough outrage from when we do stuff to each other, not talking about necessarily black on black crime, But at the end of the day, I do want to feel that same outrage when a little kid is being shot in our community, the same as when we see a cop kill a little kid in our community. I feel like it needs to be the same outrage, and we do need to stand up and make something happen.
Yeah, and I agree with that. I think that we need to, you know what, and I'll tell you, because I'm young, and I want everybody, this is the biggest thing that I like. I'm young. I work out. I'm young. I'm black. So I'm still a young person in this world, and it wasn't too long ago that I was just in high school. Still to this day, I walk around, people call me young man, right? Growing up, one out of 15 men, black men, is in jail. I had my dad in my life. My dad's father ran away from him. I have an interview, and I want anybody that's watching this to go watch it with Sway, where I cry about the absence of black fathers when I was 18 on his show. Because one of my best friend's younger brother was incarcerated. And he never got taught how to open a door, how to pull a chair, how to shake a hand, how to shave. He was lost.
Mm-hmm.
But then let me say this too, to your point. When do we stop talking about that? I don't remember. I was taken, like, this is my memory as an African-American. An African-American. Like Jason said, I was minding my business. I was doing my own thing. The next thing I know, I was halted and hopefully survived the year to eight, 6 to year long voyage to the New World. I know no languages. I was beaten repeatedly. I was forced to go by another alias and not speak my native tongue. So I lost all connections and all historic relations and lineage to anybody from before about 1806, possibly. Now I'm in America and I'm fighting their wars. Mm-hmm. I still can't vote. I finally get the right to vote. Once I get the right to vote, they're hanging me for voting if I go vote. We win the war in the North. We fight for the North.
Mm-hmm.
Those of us that are free. We get no reparations, or the $1 million reparation that Abraham Lincoln put to the side was gave to white slave masters, not fairly distributed amongst black people. We keep going on with our evolution of life. We get to the point where we establish our own businesses. We have our own communities. We have our own wealth. We have our own schools. We have our own education. And what do?
Burn it down.
They burn down Black Wall Street. Do we receive reparations? No. We move forward. What happens after that? Then the Housing Act comes, where in deeds, legally distributed by the United States of America, it says that if you are an African-American descent, or a matter of fact, if you are not a descent or Caucasian, you are not allowed to have this house. The owner, whoever has that deed, is not allowed to sell them that house. Some of that wordplay and some of that etiquette still exists in some of the paperwork today. But then you think about this. Okay, well, maybe I don't get that house. I want to go get a loan from the bank, and I want to go make my own community in my own neighborhood, just like the white folks go do, or the Americans go do, or the Caucasians, as they say it in the deeds to the houses. And they don't give me a loan because I'm black.
Mm-hmm.
This is back when. This is the Housing Act. Research this, people. These are all facts. Research Black Wall Street. You know what I'm saying? So then they create a program called Section 8, which is in Cabrini-Green, where it was supposed to be these state-of-the-art projects. And this is not just in Chicago. This is Marcy Gardens. This
everywhere. Is
where you grew up. This is all around America. So you yep. tell me that that's a coincidence.
But my
you
question me- is, but my question, yeah. here's my question.
I don't think it's
when,
coincidence.
When, no,
here's, I'm not, here's, okay,
my, here's my question. I don't live in all that shit, and I'm not discounting it because we all know that it really happened. And I love, wait, let me say this. And I love the history lesson. And for those who don't know, I'm 42. I've been around a long time. I live in a big ass house that I wanted. I got a company that I started from an idea. I took myself out the hood where I got shot. I also think that with all of the oppression that has happened and still happens, when do we start focusing on us and how we build and how we multiply and how we control the black dollar and how we control the narrative and how we stop living in the repressed past that still mentally binds us? Hold on. That still mentally binds, because if you wake up and say, damn, I'm black. I wake up every day like, I don't give a fuck what I am. I'm black, gay, and loud and disrespectful at times. But guess what? I'm going to get whatever the fuck I want. And I'm going to try to do right by the person next to me. I don't give a fuck about all that other shit, because that other shit happened.
No,
I want to even open your mind wider than that. I would say that me and you have not left the hood. I would say that me and you make every dollar that we make off of the hood. You have to understand, like I just said, as African Americans, we don't even have generational wealth. We are just now, you are the first person in your family, I'm sure, just like me and my brother are the first people to own a company that will turn into generational wealth, correct?
Right, so but that goes back to Damage's point. That's what Damage was saying. Damage was saying we need to focus on moving.
Yeah. What I hear everything you're saying. Is factual. Everything. And I'm not saying forget the oppressor at all. What I'm saying
is the oppression.
Yeah, at all. That's everything you're saying is a solid. That's solid. Like, we know that. That's facts. What I'm saying is, at this point in time, with all the resources that we do have, how can we build a better community amongst us? Like you said, I think it was your tagline, we can do better or whatever. We need to start thinking, like, all of us, how can we help each other?
Yeah.
My friend, like you said, you have a friend that grew up, didn't have his father. I have many friends that didn't grow up without their father. I didn't have a father. But we also need to, when I see a young man growing up without a father, how can I step up and play a father role for him? That's what I'm talking about, thinking like that. How can we start building our community today?
Okay, so then let's tap into something else, because these are all connected very heavily.
All saying the same thing, I think, essentially.
Yeah, we're definitely all saying the same thing. It's a very progressive conversation. But I think something that Jason said earlier that I really liked and I kind of agreed with is that the narrative of America is not controlled by the African American when it comes to entertainment. So when it comes to television, when it comes to Good Times and such shows that we've grown up on, right? So we understand that, and this is what a lot of people talk about. This is why a lot of people come for Jay-Z, a lot of people come for Beyonce, because we don't have Malcolm X, we don't have Martin Luther King, we don't have Fred Hampton. And Huey P. Newton. Our leaders are dead. And what has happened is that our new leaders, the people that we look to for answers, are on the television screen.
Or social media.
And they are. And social media. Like you, Jason, and like me. And like you.
No, so I'm not one. You're talking about like Sean King. You're talking about social media activists like Sean King, Tamika Mallory, who's actually in the streets, like those people, that's their job.
No, I'm not talking about them. I'm talking about, and that's what I'm saying, Jason. I need you to understand this shit, because it worries me. I'm younger than you. You got to know, we make our money off of the lifestyle and experiences that we have lived as a minority of this country. And there are people that take our words, and we understand this differently, because we say them, just like they take their words differently because they say them. So I say this to you. It's time for us to create some kind of group chat, pro-black, positive shit, because me and you, Jason, are trying to work out. That's why this conversation is happening. And I applaud you for that. And every gay black kid and gay white kid, straight, Asian, I don't care, that's watching this shit, congratulations, because you just tapped into some real shit. You know what I'm saying?
No, that's real. That's real. And I feel like you and your family, y'all have been doing that. You've been out there in the community. Jason has been making initiatives. He's been out there. So it's good that we are doing it. I just want us, not saying forget the oppression, but we need to really be focused on building our community. When a kid dies, no matter who does it, we need to be outraged. We need to be out there protecting our own. That's all I'm saying.
I agree with that.
But yeah, and I agree with that too. But to finish off, because I didn't finish the story of oppression that you guys said that I'm sure you guys understand because you live it. But for the listeners that might not understand, after the Housing Act, after Section 80, we are introduced to mass incarceration.
Mm-hmm.
We are introduced to the Crime Act. We are introduced to the War on Drugs. We are introduced to so many different, and it hurts me. And I'll tell you why, because I am one of those black kids that grew up on 79th Street that didn't have that. I'm lucky, Jason. We are lucky. How many other Jasons are there? And that's what we need to say to each other. How many other Jasons? Because there's other Ryan Seacrest. How many other Taylor Bennett and Chance the Rappers? There's other rappers. How many other independents? And how many of them express themselves like this? How many of them are fearless? You're not just independent. You're not just an independent owner of your company because you want to say what you want to say. You're independent because you're fearless, because you believe you could do it yourself. That's the inspiration that these young black kids need. They can't get that from the government. They can't get that from most of these people. They can't teach that to them.
So for those of you that are watching and you want to like sum up the whole oppression that he just talked about, go watch the 13th Amendment on Netflix. The 13th Amendment. The 13th Amendment on Netflix sums it all up, because I'll tell you again, even when we learn our own oppression, I'll go back to it. White people created racism, and you motherfuckers have to talk to each other so you can get it. We get it because we lived it. I've lived it. I still just get in this house. I got discriminated against and I'm suing her ass. You know what I mean? So I get it, right? But my point earlier, and just trying to define they so that way it's clear, I think we got it. When we were talking about food deserts, we were talking about government. When we're talking about the music industry, we're definitely talking about white people, because black people are not in the boardrooms making the overall decision at Sony, Columbia, Atlantic, or anywhere. I could give you all the names. I could bring pictures on the next show. They all white.
Definitely, I need you to bring pictures on the next show, because I know some black motherfuckers is working in some of those offices.
Working. We're talking about ownership, Taylor. We're talking about ownership versus working. Okay. I'm talking about owners.
No. You're right. We're definitely talking about ownership versus working. And I think that that's a big point that brings me to one of my next things. There's a lot going on in the music industry, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of people that are asking for something. And I want to say that, Jason, if you don't teach this next generation of children to run their own social media blogs, to be their own influencers, then they will
That's my next book, Taylor. It's coming out.
And what I'm saying is that, I want you to know that though, Jason, and that's why you probably don't even know it, but before I ever said this, I knew that about you. I could see that about you.
Uh-huh. Yeah, each one teach one. It's all just looking at you and your brother and how you all are doing what you do in music, it set the example for a lot of artists that have followed. And the fact that you guys are both still involved in the community, your community, you know, instead of sitting on Instagram and you and Chance talking about shootings in Chicago, you create programs for kids. So we see it, and I think that is the whole point Damage was making earlier, that like we have to start taking control of the narrative. We have to start taking control of our community. I hate watching my staff write stories about 8-year-old and 9-year-old kids getting murdered, and there's no outrage over that. Like, there's no outrage. But then if a car hits a Louis Vuitton glass window, motherfuckers is ready to send in the National Guard. But I think that's the frustration Damage that you were talking about.
Can I just tell you that I live downtown, that I ride my bike downtown, that I jog downtown. It might not be a motherfucker in this city that you will see more than me if you're outside. And there's a lot of people that could guarantee you that shit, especially downtown. Don't you let them tell you all of this shit. Don't you let them overly perpetuate the same images of our 13% on the damn screen. Don't you do that. And I'm just saying that to you as your friend. I ride down those streets. My grandma, I can't even put all that info out, but we good. We over here. I ain't had no problems. I ain't heard nobody getting beat up. I ain't heard nobody get fucked. Now, maybe they did. So if they did, then I apologize for that. But I just ain't see that. What I'm seeing is that people are outraged, like you said, about clothing. And that's why I'm saying that we as a people got to be better, because that's something that they got to do.
Yeah,
like
facts.
You said, they gotta figure that shit out.
What was like when George Floyd happened and everybody was mad about AutoZone? It's like, don't fucking tell me about AutoZone. I don't care about no AutoZone. Like,
but and this is where I want to tap in with y'all. I want y'all to know because I'm young and I'm seeing it different. Do you think they used to stop us from coming downtown back in the day and have us burn our own shit down? Mm-hmm. They never experienced this. So if no, because I gotta say this.
Okay.
If they, and again, we're talking about the government.
Yep.
I'm not talking about white people. I'm talking about
government. We on the same page now.
If they cannot handle the loss of clothing, I know y'all niggas been robbed before. If they cannot handle the feeling of losing a piece of product, then you know that they have no idea of what our oppression has really been. And that's what I want you guys to really understand.
Right. And the fact that they took everything, took everything from us. I get it.
Yeah. They're not, I mean, they're just, you know, my whole thing, like I said, is that everybody needs to be more educated. I think one of the biggest tools of racism is segregation. That's why I wore that rainbow underwear on my album cover, because I knew people were going to talk about me. And I'm okay.
Those were hot, by the way.
Thank you. And that's why I like you. We know people are going to talk about us, Jay. We cool with that. That's cool.
What I'm confused about when it comes to segregation is why can every other ethnicity, race, or culture have their own and still be a part of the world and society, but we can't do it? You know what I'm saying? There's always been a Chinatown. There's Chinese banks, everything. Same for the Jewish community. Same for almost every community. But it seems like when we do it, now it's like a big problem. What is wrong with us building and creating our own infrastructure and our own community, but still acting in society?
Man, I think I think that we can all be better at the end of the day. You know, I think there's a lot of different, you know, excuses. I think there's a lot of things we could say, but, you know, like I said, you know, it doesn't always have to be a physical program. There's a virus going on right now. Everybody can't be somewhere, but me and Jason had a pretty cool idea. We talked about the other day on the phone, working out together on live and sharing that with our audience.
He had me by a waist trainer. He had me by a waist trainer.
I'm trying to the Pendleton. I'm trying to get you to get good, but do these little simple things for our fans, because like I said, it's not all about money. A lot of it is about education. A lot of it is about resources. And yes, you can't get a lot of those resources without money, but that's why people like me and you have money, Jason, so we could give that back to our people and we could funnel that education back to them. So
let me ask you a few questions. Let me ask you a few questions and see what you think about these things, okay? So we talked a lot about what was happening with the rioting or the looting in Chicago that we see on the news. We're not on the ground, you are. What do you think about your mayor? I mean, she's been doing a good job of defending the city, at least from the outside. Yeah. Are you guys happy with her?
Yeah, you know, I'll say I am not too familiar with all of Lori's practices. She's definitely a member of the LGBTQ and also the Black community. And, you know, those aren't the only reasons I support her. She's extremely intelligent. I know that in her years of work before becoming the mayor, she helped, I believe, prosecute and do a couple different things that were really helpful to the city and whatnot. So, I mean, she's doing a pretty good job. I think that right now it's a difficult timing. You got COVID, you got, you know, everything that's going on right now with, you know, clearly the protest and everything. And I think that one thing is that she's not a middleman. And I can say I like that about her. She is not somebody that is just like, you don't know what she's doing. If she makes a statement or if she addresses something, it's very clear, and she's pretty persistent on making sure that she takes care of that or that she pursues those actions. So, you know, like I said, I live downtown. You know, she installed a curfew, I believe, the past 2 to 3 nights. I had to ride my bike around a bunch of different bridges just to make it back to my house. But, you know, I got back home and I rode my bike this morning again. And, you know, throughout the whole city, it looked real nice. So, you know, yeah, I got love for Lori. You know, I just wanted to keep pushing and keep trying to, you know, make things better for my city.
All right, y'all, it's time for another Hollywood hookup. Now, with everything going on right now, a lot of people are asking if it's even possible to buy life insurance at all. And the answer is yes. It's still easy to shop for life insurance right now. And if you have loved ones, depending on your income, you probably should. Right now, you can save $1,500 or more a year by using Policy Genius to compare life insurance policies. When you're shopping for a policy that could last for a decade or more, those savings really start to add up. So what is Policy Genius? It's an insurance marketplace built and backed by a team of industry experts. And here's how it works. Step one, head to policygenius.com. In minutes, you can work out how much coverage you need, compare quotes from top insurance to find your best price. Step two, apply for your lowest price. Step three, the Policy Genius team will handle all the paperwork and red tape. Policy Genius works for you, not the insurance company. So if you hit any speed bumps during the application process, they'll take care of everything. They even have policies which allow eligible customers to skip the in-person medical exam and do it over the phone. That kind of service has earned Policy Genius a 5-star rating across 1,600 reviews on Trustpilot and Google. So this is how you get it done. If you need life insurance, head to policygenius.com right now to get started. You can save $1,500 or more a year by comparing quotes on their marketplace. Policy Genius, when it comes to insurance, it's nice to get it right. And that's your Hollywood hookup.
That's genius. So you've been open about being bisexual. You and I have had conversations offline, which we don't need to get into the details of that, but we do look and see when people pop up online that they're bisexual, it's almost, or gay, it's become almost like a marketing thing in some respect. What gave you the courage to just be open with who you were from the beginning? Cause like you didn't become bisexual when you got a record deal or something. You were very.
And I don't have a record deal.
but yeah, you know what I'm saying. Like you didn't have.
You're right. I got money. You know what? And I'll just be honest with you, Jason. I feel like, and I'm not gonna even say I feel like I have never told anybody this, but I'll tell you, because I think that people need to know this, and I haven't said them on specific platforms because they are not the platform where my people need to hear this shit. I came out because I was in Miami and I got a call from one of my friends and he said, "Hey," it's like, "Hey man, you been on your phone lately? You been on Twitter?" And I'm like, "Nah." He was like, "You might want to check it. I think that somebody's saying that they got some pictures of possibly your genitalia or some shit like that floating around the internet."
Hold on a minute. I missed that one when I was doing my research. I'll get back. Go ahead.
Check out my story. I was like, that can't be true. Can't be right. So I basically ended up doing my research. I'm looking. It's not mine, right? It's not mine. But it's so fucking goofy. It's not mine. But what there is I had some conversations, you know, some openly basically gay or bisexual conversations. And I felt this pressure that this is why I said I wanted to talk about this on your platform, because I don't know how you came out, Jason, but I believe a lot of us as black men are outed. Yeah. So it's a situation where, and it's so dangerous, and it's actually a very sensitive thing. This is why I say it to you, because I know, or I think I've seen you post, I've been posting a lot about black trans women and the exponential difference in rate of murders and harm that is done upon them. And a lot of those, these guys or whatever the fuck, and it's so fucking sad. Their story is this guy thought they were going to say something, or he thought somebody was going to find out and this happened and whatever. And he killed. That human, he killed that person. That is so dangerous that we feel like that as men, that we feel that we can't express ourselves that we feel so, so entitled to our reputation.
And fearful of judgment.
Mm-hmm. Not just fearful of judgment, fearful of death.
Yeah.
Fearful from both sides. Do you see? And I think that's like just a very scary thing. I think that's a very, very scary thing. So basically my situation is of that. So, you know, there were some text messages floating around online. You know, and I was just like, I don't want anybody to out me, like anybody that I've ever had a relationship with. And I feel like I'm about to be 21. I'm black. I have money. My brother has money. My family loves me. Like, my family loves me. And that's one thing that a lot of us don't have in our community is parents that we know will support us. So that made my journey and me coming out very different. But I also knew that anybody that was going to feel differently about me at that point in my life, fuck you. I don't need you, you know? And I always tell this story, and it doesn't hit the same, and I want to apologize to a lot of people because I haven't shared that story correctly. But once I put that out, I had 5 or 10 minutes where people were calling me, friends were calling me, close friends, because I didn't tell anybody. I don't know if you know this, Jason, but I didn't tell anybody.
I didn't know your coming out story.
I literally just... Well, I mean, not just that, but like, I'm literally saying when I came out, I didn't tell anybody. Like, I told my dad. My dad was right next to me. He was outside. And I told him that I had actually just tweeted it. But I didn't tell any of my friends. I had been in the closet for so many different years. And the whole thing, like I say, I feel like was just like I had 5 or 10 minutes where people were hitting me up and they're like, yo, is this right? I think somebody hacked your account. And I had the opportunity to take that shit back. And I think about that all the time. I had the opportunity to say that wasn't it, and this was, and this happened. But the fucking support that I got when I came out on my Twitter from my followers is the only reason why I am still out to this day. Mm-hmm. That's what we need. It hurts me so much to understand that we live in this fear of something that doesn't even really exist. Racism is an invisible thing. Homophobia is an invisible thing. But they sure do kick our ass, you know? So,
did coming out bring you and your brother and your family closer?
Yeah, I think in a bit of regard, I think because I think it made us feel like, even though, because I'm the youngest brother, right? And I don't know if any of you guys are the youngest brother, but I think that once the youngest is done growing up, it kind of evaporates that family environmental feel that you have, where it's like, oh, let me call Chance, or let me call my dad, or let me call my mom, and let me make sure that it, because we're not living together. And it kind of, I'm sure for a lot of people, it kind of puts this feeling on you like you should feel like that. Like, everybody should feel like, okay, now this is over. I've done what I've done. But I think that was one of the things that made us say, we got to get back in. You know what I'm saying? Like, we got to check on each other a little bit more. Like, we got to be a little bit more in touch, or a little bit more in depth with, you know, each other's lives. So, yeah, I think it definitely, in a way, brought us closer. But I think that, if anything, it made me feel comfortable being who I am. And like I said way earlier in this conversation about the tiger and the man that beats him and oppresses him senselessly until the point that he does not know himself, it makes you fragile. And I'm so happy that I can be who I am and that I can express who I am. I'm so happy that I could find somebody that loves me for me. Like, I'm so, like, Kayla is such a blessing, because there's a lot of people. I've known Kayla. A lot of people don't know this. I've known Kayla since I was 13 years old.
Oh, wow.
I've known Kayla. Chicago is a small fucking city. I've known Kayla since I was 13 years old. I was hitting Kayla up on Facebook, bruh. And I know that y'all like, nigga, I was on Black People Meets. The fuck you talking about? But to me, that shit is crazy. I was talking to her on Facebook and I was telling her, and it's like, God makes everything happen for a reason. I feel like that's one of the biggest things that I say is like, I definitely came out for me, but I was going to be doing or not doing whatever the fuck I was doing, regardless of if I told somebody or not. We all know that. Mm-hmm. But what I got from it is I got to see other people accept me for me. And I got mm-hmm. to see other people accept themselves for who they are. I got to see, mm-hmm. I have friends that came out literally very much so, close time spans. And I don't take that lightly. I don't take the interview that I did with Charlamagne lightly, talking about the matter and talking about Young Thug and Lil Uzi Vert wearing purses. I cannot perpetuate the inaccurate image that is painted of our community constantly. You know,
and I love the fact that people are starting to become a little bit more open-minded to the fact that we all don't wear purses. We all don't wear makeup. We all don't wear heels. We are masculine. We will whoop your ass. We are smart. We are business owners. We are educators. We're everything that you think we're not, you know, and we're not all what you think we are. So I love that you've, you know, the Be Yourself campaign is so brilliant. By the way, you never have the color that I want. So I never
want.
I mean, I would love red. Oh, red's my favorite color.
Red. Oh yeah, I don't think I have a red one. I definitely
Let me keep losing this weight and I'll let you know.
Hey, I'm gonna buy Jason this little bitty ass hoodie and we just gonna put it on a hanger right in front of his treadmill and every day you just gonna stare at that shit.
Listen, I just went to Neiman Marcus and bought a bunch of shit I could never have fit. So I'm like over here. Now I got to go return it though, because I ain't going to be able to fit it. But look, okay.
They say do that. They say buy a bunch of shit. You rich. You could do shit like that, Jason.
We're not going to throw the rich word around. The IRS is listening. All right, look, but I will say that I didn't know. Look, we could be talking forever. And I think that we need to, like, whenever you want to do the show again, just to shoot the shit and go at it. Like, let's plan topics that we could just go at it about, because, you know, yeah, you're 24, but you're smart. And, you know, and the other thing is that there are young millennials who are 24 or younger who are living in the shit that I haven't lived in. Like, I lived in an era that you didn't. You're living in an era in a way that I haven't, or you see things in a way that I don't. So I think there's a value for being able to exchange ideas and exchange experiences. So
thank you so much. Yeah. To say, I always knew that I was gonna have to do this whenever I did the show. Maybe this is why it took me so long, because I felt like it's gonna be a hard thing to do. But I've always known that I couldn't come on your show and not comment about how much of an impact you've made on my life as an artist, how big of an inspiration you are to me as a Black man, as somebody that is also represented in your community, as somebody that is an independent business owner, as a representation of somebody that, like you said, is older than me and has lived through other generations and has broken down walls for things so I can do the things that I do, right? Because when I tell motherfuckers my friend is Jason Lee, they know I'm not fucking around. And I appreciate that.
I know most of them be like, man, be careful with that guy. You know, people on the outside, they don't know us, but it's all good.
And my whole thing is like, we don't want to know y'all. Like, that's really how I feel. Like, I figured that out at a young age. When I was 18, I was like, look, it's some motherfuckers that want to sit around at their crib and they want to talk shit. And there's some motherfuckers that want to go to the club. And then it's us.
Right.
That's it. You know what I'm saying?
So Taylor's been trying to get me to do this fitness thing on Instagram. Once I'm really ready to get, because you up and down the Smith rack. You and Damage are like on the same fitness level right now. I got weighted balls and kettlebells and shit downstairs that are still in boxes, but I'm unpacking them every day. So when I get there, we're going to do something, because like I said, if people aren't following Taylor, you need to follow him on Instagram and you need to look at just daily. It's just this daily motivation and to see your body transform. You know, I saw you the other day doing the roller thing. I didn't order the roller. Now, you know, my ass ain't gonna roll right now, but I got one. You know what I mean?
That's what Floyd does. So like, You know what I'm saying? Even you telling me that, and I think, oh, shit, I almost didn't say this on this show, but I know I said it to you the other day when we were talking about doing this. Jason, we'll never understand as people how big of an impact just our small comments have on people. I can tell you throughout my whole fitness journey from the very beginning to the end, the slightest things that you would say, whether it was just keep going or it was you looking slim or you looking good or whatever it was, like, you know that as people, we can act like we don't want attention as much as we want, but we all some little attention whores in some way. We really appreciate when somebody acknowledges us. And I think that us, like people that are at whatever level this is, they feel like they don't really need to do that, or they feel like people get tired of that, or they feel like it's just, but I really do appreciate that. And I want you to know that's why I feel so that I got to help you do what you did, because you did really help me get to where I'm at. So I appreciate it.
Thank you. Sometimes it was you're looking good. Sometimes it was the drooling emoji, whatever. It all translates the same. Sometimes I'm in an Uber. I ain't got time to say type shit. I just drooling emoji. You get the point. Wait, look, one more thing too. I have to give you, your brother, Common, Dwayne Wade, all of you who did what you did in Chicago during the fucking All-Star, y'all fucking killed it. You put on for your city. I've never really been to All-Star game. I didn't really know I was in love with basketball players like that. Like now I'm at every All-Star game, but I will tell you, your brother's performance, you know, I know you were one of the captains, right? Or you were involved with.
I performed the night before too. So I did the rookie games and then Chance did like the other shit. Yeah.
I mean, you performed. Common's performance was fire. Barack Obama in the building. I mean, it was such, yeah. I mean, I don't care what people's outside perception of what Chicago is from the media. If you were shit, it made me feel like I was proud to be from Chicago.
You would know. And you would know that, you know, like, you know, King used to say, you know, within darkness, you know, you always find light. So yeah, man, you know, it's a beautiful, beautiful city. And I appreciate you having your eyes open. And I want you, you know, you got to come to Chicago and you got to let me help you explore this place and really show you, you know, what this city is about. And maybe you could show, you know, the rest of the world. So.
Well, I have to come at a time you're not doing shit, because Taylor, you know, you be busy. I went to see you at Jimmy Kimmel. I probably got 3 minutes of your attention. I know you had to perform and all that. You're a star. But you know
it's different in Chicago. And then All-Star, I was busy, but that's because we was doing all that stuff. But it's different, man. When I'm in Chicago, I just be, like I said, people in Chicago, they'll be in the comments. They be, oh, yeah, I see him on Michigan. I see him on State. And then I just be outside.
All right. Well, me and Damage will figure out a time to come to Chicago. You could take us to Z451. I can't really eat right now, but I'll try to nibble on some shit. Pause.
Right?
All right. Look, Taylor Bennett, follow him. Is there new music? Any music you need to shout out now or anything? Because
yeah, you know, make sure you get my last single, Good Guy. And then make sure you guys get Be Yourself Part 2, my new single that's going to be dropping in a couple weeks.
Okay, cool. And I'm going to be wearing a Be Yourself red hoodie here on this show whenever I get it sent to me. And I'll pay for it too, because I believe in supporting my brother. So
I appreciate you, Jason.
This was long overdue. Come back anytime. And I mean that, like, literally, if you want to come back in a couple, whenever you want to come back, because you have good talk. And I love the fact that you're not afraid to argue. Like, come on, let's debate.
We're not sensitive. You know that. Yeah. So, yeah, thank you, Jason. I love you. I really appreciate the opportunity as always. And thank you, Damage. Really appreciate, you know, all your input on everything. Honored to be on the show. Love Hollywood Unlocked. Can't wait to be back, guys.
All right. I'm about to go Google your nudes. So, thank you. We're gone. Bye.
I exist again. Goodbye.
What up, YouTube? Thank you for watching this reckless show.
Yeah, and hit that subscribe button, and don't forget to hit the notification bell.
And also don't forget to share and leave a comment, because we are reading.